Hello there, everyone. Welcome to Scene Queen LSG episode 9 with String Theory this week. Hold on a second. Let me bring Lisa's mic up. Lisa, you there?
I am.
Okay, great.
Can you hear me?
Hold on. Yep, let me get you in the video. We're going to be trying something different this week. We actually did a almost live interview with String Theory last night at the Red Rock Tavern in Hartford, which was supposed to be somewhere else.
Yeah, we were supposed to do it at Billings Forge, where they're going to have their CD release on Saturday, except there was a little bit of a logistical mess up, so the kind folks at Red Rock Tavern said, you know what, come on in, do your thing, and I think it was pretty cool because they actually got treated to some live music on a Monday night at Red Rock Tavern, so it was pretty cool.
Yeah, I was kind of impressed that they could, that they just walked in there and said, hey, can we play some music and, you know, just kind of do some, you know, do an interview here. We did pick the wrong night. It was pool night. There's going to be a lot of noise on the audio. It was pool night. There was a women's game on. The first part's a little quieter than the second part, though. So, anyway.
Oh, so did you pick some of that up in the interview?
It's a little noisy, but it's not as bad as it could have been. That was really loud in there. I mean, it was very loud in there.
So. It was, but it was fun nonetheless. So.
And we have a couple good bloopers too.
Excellent. Well,
the word of the day is pomegranate.
And you know what? So are we going to go with the drinking game thing? Because I think that every time we say pomegranate, somebody should take a shot.
Well, I got that a glass of wine.
You, Amy. I know where you are, skinny girl.
Is Amy there? She's not said anything in the chat room yet. So.
She's supposed to be.
And I spelled string theory wrong on our chat.
She actually, what's funny is she just texted me and said that she ran into Joel at somewhere in Newington just a few minutes ago. And he gave her a sneak preview of Little Elephant, so that was kind of cool too.
Oh, did she pick up the disc or?
Yes, she did. She is now proud owner of Little Elephant.
Yeah, it's a good. I was listening to it today. I sucked it into iTunes. It's not registering though, but that's okay. I mean, I don't think they put it up there yet. So.
Oh. Okay.
All right. Well, we got a couple of. Hey, there's me. Okay, never mind. Thought I had you up. We have a couple things to talk about. I'd just like to welcome our new additions to Local Band Review. That's Shawn Morse from White Bangs Touring. And David Golden from WPKN is doing a podcast for us now, probably weekly. We actually just released two. They're up on iTunes already. So, yeah, you can get the podcast at either our website and in his weekly feature. We also have a new site called podcast.localbandreview.com, and his is under Radio Golden. We're also going to make all the Scene Queens a podcast too and get those up there. Probably have to rate them explicit though or something.
Fun. Welcome to them. I'm pretty excited. We've actually got some guys now on the team.
Yeah, and actually, they're actually, like, contributing.
Fantastic.
If you don't know the story, I've asked so many guys to help me with this, and we've always ended up with women. You guys just get the job done. I don't know. We're a bunch of snacks.
That's right. The women get the job done. Except, you know, we'll see what these guys do now. They're gonna need to bring a little bit.
Well, they're good.
You hear that? Sean, David, bring it.
I see who's a Cretan? That's
Amy.
That's Amy. Hi, Amy. See you in the chat.
So we welcome the new guys. What else do you got going on? What have you been up to? We haven't chatted in a couple weeks.
Yeah, we had to you had some issues, some family issues, and had to get you got called away the other week last minute. So we muddled through Fight the Fear. I think people missed you.
Aww.
So, but we did get through it. It was kind of hard doing all this switching without you know, somebody else talking. It's probably going to be difficult tonight, too, because it's just me and you. But then we do have a break because we pre-recorded. I'd also like people's input on what they think of that. Somebody said saying the F word a lot.
Wait, what?
I'm just looking at the chat room. It said saying the F word. Oh, I'm now you. I got to change this thing. Okay. Yeah, see, I'm falling behind the doing the things here.
Well, you know that I'll say a whole lot of F-bombs. You know that. I can guarantee it.
I know. It's okay. And we are also up for the Hartford Currents music blog. So we've got a link on the Facebook page. We don't have it on the site yet because it's just the nomination phase. So we're just getting
show us some love, you guys.
Yeah. So just send us a, you know, just keep putting us in there. What else is there? Okay, and I did the Chi Cheng benefit. If nobody knows who that is, that's the Deftones bassist who was injured in a car accident in 2008, and he's been in a semi-vegetative state. So it was a good show. We had we had Fight the Fear, who we interviewed the couple days before. We had Down Monday, and John Ryan was here, and we interviewed him. I'd never seen Karmic Justice, but that's by Big Jim's in that band. He puts on a bunch of benefits. He's a really good guy from New Haven, and the posse from the Shore was there. So I got to meet some people I'd not met that I only knew through Facebook, so that was kind of interesting. And the other band was A Silent Protest. And people have been asking me to film them forever, and I just never got to them, so... Anyway, so what have you been up to? You've been gone a month.
Yeah, I've been a couple of weeks. I had a really good experience. I was a frat boy for a night at Eclectic in Middletown, which is literally a frat house. Elise Lamb from EULA gave me a shout and said, you know, we're going to be doing this show with No Age, which is this really cool band out of L.A., who Cynthia knows, I got there and it literally was in a frat house, and it was high energy. I knew it was going to be a problem when the handles started marching in along with the cases. Elise and the boys kicked the room's ass. They just did. Elise is always so much fun to watch, and I just love her to death. And the guys from No Age, the room was absolutely mobbed, and it turned into this just seething pit of people that were just surging to the stage. It was crazy. I kind of hung at the back of the stage, like behind, because I started to get a little nervous. I'm getting too old for this shit, really. And so that was a lot of fun. And then, you know, it was St. Patrick's Day Mayhem, that following, not this Saturday, but the Saturday before. I don't know why they did St. Patrick's Day parades the week before. Is that like a scheme to build, get more money out of the bars? Is that what it is?
I don't know, but you obviously didn't recover enough to do the blog, because you guys, and I saw you and Jen. I knew it was all over when you were doing the Scorpion Bowl at lunch.
Oh, yeah. It was, you know, I'm still bruised from jumping over the barrier that's supposed to keep you out of the parade, but that's just nonsense. You should be able to march in the parade if you want to, free will. So I do. I got a huge bruise on the top of my foot, on my leg. I was beaten and battered, but it was so much fun. The Hartford Parade is a lot of fun, and I know a lot of people go to the New Haven Parade, which is that Sunday. I haven't gone in years, but I know that they have a good time there too. So we did parades. Wow, what else happened over the last week? Lots of stuff. We'll talk some more maybe during the break while
okay. Yeah, let me tell people what we're going to do. So last night we filmed an interview, like we mentioned, and what we're going to do is we're going to be quiet for about 11 minutes for the first part of it and play it. It's actually a fun interview. The String Theory guys are hilarious. And anyway, without further ado, let me see if I can roll that up
here. Yeah, and you know, we really want to thank the guys from String Theory. It was just so much fun. They were a lot of fun. They were good sports about it, and then you know they played amazingly. So you know, thanks you guys. You're awesome. Love you very much.
Yeah,
awesome.
We did that video in one take. That was it. You know, it was pretty cool. Oh, I'm frozen again. What is up with my mic? I'm just in this one.
Technical issues.
I don't know. I rebooted the computer this time, so I don't know what's going on. Okay, we'll be back in about 11 minutes, so sit back and enjoy the interview. Let us know what you think, too. We'll do more of these if you like them. They're definitely better quality than what you're getting now over the webcam. So.
Yeah, and it was a lot of fun. I want to do it more often.
Okay, off we go. This may be a little glitchy here as I get going. Hold on.
Hi, this is Scene Queen LSG. We are actually on site at Red Rock in Hartford. We had planned to be at Billings Forge at the studio, but some things happened, so we didn't make it there. But we've been given the opportunity to do this at Red Rock instead, so thanks to the folks here in Hartford. What do you need me to do? Talk louder? Okay. So I'm here with String Theory. How awesome is that? Yay!
Thank you! Woo!
So we've got
we're happy to be here.
So we've got Joel Welch, who is
White, actually.
Is that how you say it?
Yeah. Wake. It's like White. White. But with a K.
White?
But with a K.
White.
White. Yeah.
White. Joel White.
Yeah.
I've got that. Joel is an amazing guitar player for String Theory. And then we have our wonderful percussionist, Jordan Critchley. And I've got a lesson in how to do your name. So Carl Messerschmidt.
Ooh, not bad. Yes. Solid.
Is that pretty good?
Yes. Solid. That's good.
Amazing bass player for String Theory. So we're here talking to them today because they are going to be releasing a CD. Actually, this one right here.
Yeah.
It's called Little Elephant. Yeah. it's been highly anticipated by the local
probably
music
mostly
community.
By us for the last 19 months.
No, by other people too. We've really been waiting to see this, so I'm excited about it. So I'm here to ask you guys a couple of questions to talk about it. And so you can decide who's going to answer. So, String Theory, when and where did you guys get together? How did you start? Who started the band? How did this happen?
Okay, so what happened was I knew that it was time to take my music out of my house and get it outside. I met Carl at a Starbucks in Plainville and heard through the grapevine locally that he was an excellent bass player. And a friend of mine, the one who ultimately introduced me to Frank Giorgini, the guy who taught me and Jordan how to make the inner drums, she invited me to a friend's birthday party, and it ended up being Carl's. We didn't even know each other than a customer and barista relationship. And then I saw him just start shredding on the bass at some open mic, and I had to work with this guy.
I remember you said to me, you were like, we could go places with this guy. And I wasn't even in the band yet, but you were just like, we could go places. And I was like, wow, so, I can't wait to hear him.
Yeah, it's actually kind of it was a dramatic period of time because the week I was starting the band, or the couple weeks that I was, and I had connected with Carl, Jordan was on a road trip, cross country, and going to California and coming back. And I sent out a message on Facebook, and I think an email too, saying, any percussionists, please let me know if you're interested in joining an instrumental world fusion style band. And I had a few people get back to me that were interested, but Jordan's response was the most heartfelt and passionate response that I think I had ever read to a call for a musician. So I didn't even want to do auditions. I just wanted to work with him at that point.
Come on,
seriously.
Yeah, pretty much like when he said that, I was on the road trip and I knew that these guys were trying out other percussionists. Now, I'm not like a percussionist. I wouldn't say I've never gone to school. I didn't like really like know what I was doing, but I had rhythm and I really, really really have always liked Joel's music. We've been friends forever.
He actually wanted to be my manager when I was like 17.
Yeah.
You remember? I don't know if you remember, you took
Yeah, I was literally like, hey, if you ever decide to do anything, I want to be a part of it.
Was it in the hat?
Oh, no, no.
This
hat.
Was free.
The free hat.
This is just, on the road trip, I bought the hat though. I totally did. Yeah, and I was just like, man, like, I really, really, really want to be a part of this in any way, shape, or form. It sucked because I couldn't be because I was a wet. And then, so they were auditioning and auditioning, and I was like, no!
Well,
like,
he thought we were. We didn't actually audition.
Yeah, I thought, yeah.
I just posted the message, but
we didn't try anyone.
People emailed back, but we didn't audition.
So during the road trip, I was like, I was listening to some of his old tracks that he had, and I was just like, okay, like, what would I do on that? And how would I kind of like prep myself so if there was an audition for me, I'd like kind of start the process. So I literally like shut all the lights off when I finally got home and just like popped in that one song. And I said, hey, I want to do this one song. And if you like what I do to it, you know, that'll like, let me know. You know, so he's like, okay. So I shut all the lights off and I was playing to it. And I worked on it, worked on it. It wasn't like I slaved over it. I'll be honest. It was probably a total of 3 hours worth of work just to kind of really get it.
That's a lot.
But then I showed it to Joel and I tried it. It was E minor. That was the very first song.
I love E minor.
Yeah, and he kind of like, after he was done, he played it live, and he's like, all right, now do it again. But this time, he played it really, really quiet, so he was really focused on what I was actually doing. And then he's like, I really like what you do with the djembe. But he totally did not, like, give me the, like, green light. It was just like, no, that was pretty good.
You were just messing with him.
I don't know what I was doing. I like to sleep on things, you know?
Yeah, but that's
I don't like
good.
To make snap decisions.
I think that's awesome. He took it really seriously, and I think that's what really made it kind of start off as a really rock bass, because it wasn't like, hey, let's just get together and jam, you know what I mean? It was like, no, like, he already knew right away that Carl was like, yeah, is nasty, so he wanted to make sure that this was going to be, you know, solid. Admit it. He never will. That's why we love him, too. He never will. He's very humble. He's professional.
All right, so the name String Theory. How did that string theory?
That was born when I used to work at Women's Health USA in Avon. I was at work talking to a few coworkers, tossing around ideas for a band name, and not really happy with any of them, and came across String Theory as an option. I think it was actually recommended by my friend. It was either Rafe or Josh. I apologize, guys. I don't remember which one of you it was. But then another coworker of mine suggested the German spelling, which is with the T-H-E-O-R-I-E.
And yeah.
So we had something that there wasn't already a stringtheory.com taken, which was nice. There wasn't already an @stringtheory Twitter handle taken.
I'm
you know, everything was open.
Because isn't that
in that spelling,
of...
though, T-H-E-O-R-I-E,
right.
The German spelling,
okay. Right.
There's tons of stuff in the traditional spelling.
Yeah.
You know, quantum physics and all that jazz, but no bands were doing
okay, so wait
that
a minute.
Spelling.
This didn't have anything to do with quantum physics? Just
One of the reasons I picked it is because I'm interested in that stuff, and one of the principles of string theory that I remember reading was something to the effect of fundamentally all particles are vibrating strings, and when the band was first formed, it was just string bass and guitar, and I think one of the first theories of string theory was based on 11 dimensions of space and time, and Carl had just gotten a 5-string bass, so he had the 6 guitar strings, 5 bass strings, 11 strings total.
11 dimensions.
11 dimensions of space and time.
Trippy.
And time.
Although, trippy.
Although we're not, it's not something we ever really like talk about regularly, and it's not what our music is written about. It's just the name that kind of has something in common with something that some of us are interested in.
Okay, that works. It's very cool. You,
yes,
or was the band, have major sponsorship.
Oh, the band is sponsored by Ovation.
By Ovation?
Yes.
Oh my God. Because they think you're awesome like we do.
They really like the music, and they like the fact that I pretty much exclusively play Ovation guitars. And Jordan,
that helps.
Jordan plays a lot of Latin percussion brand instruments, LP brand, which are part of the Fender family of companies. So they're all kind of tied together.
Nice.
So I think they saw a lot of opportunity to show off some of the qualities of their instruments in a very diverse way in their trio, that in a way that they would really shine, because there's nothing else kind of getting in the way. Each of them really can come through.
And it does. All three of you are amazing collectively and individually.
What we're going for, so I'm glad
yeah, we translating went, we well. We went to an open mic at in Farmington, and it was sponsored by Ovation. And we went to this for that reason, because we wanted to let Ovation to see what we do, and for those reasons, too. So it's not just like we're just playing, and then by the way.
Oh, yeah. We
it was a mission. This was a mission. No, it was, though. Because so we went, and then the guy filming was Danny Bouillon, and hopefully I said that right.
Yeah.
And he was like, wow, I really like this. This is definitely something we don't have. You know, because he's also thinking, okay, what does he have in his quiver? And we were something a little different. So he was like, okay, let me get back to him. What, like 5 months later, 6 months later, or less?
Yeah.
He just said, you know, I think we can work this out. So it sounds like really cool sponsorship, but really it's not.
Come on.
It's not. No, I mean, not to be disrespectful. I'm just saying, you know, it's nice to have something to talk about, but at the same time, for me anyway, it's like, you gotta go out and play anywhere, any time, any day, and you're just trying to get your music out there. So
absolutely.
I wouldn't feel too highly.
Well,
we were fortunate enough to get a free guitar from them, though.
Oh yeah, that's true.
That's a beautiful thing.
That's
true.
Great. And it actually resulted in writing, I think, like 4 or 5 new songs, just because it's a long scale neck, so we can tune it a little bit lower.
Good point.
Than we used to. So that's been a really kind of revolutionary new instrument in the arsenal.
That's a bonus.
Yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely. Well, yeah. So, Little Elephant is your first full studio release.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
Oh, hello.
Oh, sorry. We're full with this.
Yes, here.
I got blueberries, ambergris, coffee, and no more of that.
No more of this orange.
I got.
How about pomegranate?
Pomegranate.
Excellent. Thank you.
This is gonna make me outtake.
Excuse me. We have pomegranate.
Great.
Thank
you.
Okay, that was String Theory with Lisa and me. I was doing all the filming, obviously. Lisa, you back?
Pomegranate.
Yeah, the video's a little bit skippy there. I don't know what's going on. Anyway, welcome back. So what did you think of our waitress?
You know what? I could not believe that. Well, she had to be... What, 70? And,
well,
excuse me, I don't have this anymore. What, I have blueberry, I have pomegranate. Okay, you
yeah,
don't have
this
anymore.
But she didn't
call
it pomegranate, okay. She called it something else. So
what did
funny.
She say?
I don't know, it was, I'd have to replay it. Or we have the outtake, so.
Yeah, she was, that was an interesting little occurrence. It was kind of fun. You can't make that stuff up. Then she just stumbled right in there and just didn't matter. It was great.
It was a lot of fun.
They're promoting this CD, Little Elephant. They're going to have their CD release party, which is going to be amazing on Saturday night. So do we want to go back to what else has been going on?
We can talk about them a little bit. This CD release party sounds kind of interesting because it's not just the release party. They're moving it next door, and it's at Billings Forge, which was where we were supposed to tape. Hold on a second, my volume's down here. And we ended up around the corner, but then it's moving over to the Firebox, which is next to the Billings Forge, so...
Right, so they're gonna have at their party. I guess they've got special surprises that they wouldn't go into because they didn't want to spoil it. They've got an opener. His name is escaping me right now, but they're very excited about it, and they're gonna talk about it a little bit in the second half of the interview. He's a guitar player out of New York that they're just psyched that he's coming to play for them. And then once that's over, over the Firebox. To see Mob Jack and Little Ugly, who are gonna play at the after party. So this is a really big, it's a big event. I think it's where you want to be next Saturday night. I know a lot of folks have been waiting for this CD, myself included. And it's awesome. I will tell you that I've listened to it. And actually, I was really happy to see that Chip McCabe picked that as an album of the day with very good reason. It's just, it's terrific. I think everybody should have a copy of it. It's so different and versatile, and they're all amazing musicians. So,
yeah, we did want to note that if you do get the CD, they're going to be hanging out stickers because the order of the songs are wrong. So they're supposed to be. I didn't get the exact list, but I know some are right, some are wrong. They turn up okay when you suck them into your
sticker. Well, they're going to have stickers. Yeah, that's Joel's job, is to sticker the back of the CDs with the appropriate track list.
Well, you got to love technical issues.
Gotta love it.
The other thing is that the week after, remember, that's this Saturday at Billings Forge at 6 o'clock, which is kind of early, but it sounds like it's going to be an all-night party, and it's going to keep moving. And it's going to be pretty exciting. Oop, come on. It's like I can't hear me here. And then we're the week after is what?
It's one more week after that. Right?
No. I don't think so. It's the 31st, right? Hello? Oh, we may have lost Lisa here. Okay, hopefully she can get back in here. But anyway, the week after is Swan Day, and that is up on the 31st, which is a Saturday, and that starts... let me switch over. She's definitely hung over there. And that'll be at Dirt Salon, which is across from the old Spaghetti Warehouse, if you know where that is. And that starts also at 6 o'clock at night. So, anyway, since we've lost Lisa, I'm just going to roll the second interview portion here. She's been having computer issues, so let's go over here.
I gotta go back. So Little Elephant is your first full release, studio release. What's the significance of the name, Little Elephant? What is that?
Anyone can feel this, I think.
It's a song.
Yeah, it's a song on the album. It's
really?
Kind of cute.
Yeah. It's that simple.
Yeah, we were looking at the song names, and that one just seemed like it would make a good album. As opposed to doing something that I think we felt like we were trying to force other versions of the name that we came up with.
Yeah.
And I actually ran these all past my girlfriend Caroline, and she thought Little Elephant made a really catchy, memorable band name. And the fact that it is something on our album is kind of nice. And it's a song that was one of the first that we started to play together. So
yeah. Remember why you called it that?
Little Elephant?
Yeah.
Yes, actually.
That's really funny.
It was. It had to do with my boss, my ex-boss, and my coworker. They both had the same way in which they would walk around the building. They wore high heels, and it was a distinctive sound.
Yeah, this is
and,
funny.
So no one could tell which one of them was coming because they sounded the same. And I remember mentioning that to my boss Jeanette at the time, and she said, "Well, we both march around this office like little elephants." And I thought that was really, it stuck out in my head, I guess. Yeah, it seemed like a good song name, so
nice.
That's where it came from. The song kind of got this like heavy stomping sound, but it's not an acoustic guitar, so it's not like a full-grown, angry, big war elephant on an electric guitar, even though it's kind of an aggressive acoustic guitar song, so it's like a little elephant, you know?
And we're actually going to play that later for you, so.
Yeah.
Yay! Okay, so I'm going to ask you this, and I think you probably know that I'm going to ask you this, because I really like this story. Tell everyone the I Don't Like It story. It's a song on your album. It's the first song. And I want to say
how it became named
I don't like it. Well, I
had written a song on a Friday night, or Saturday night, and I was having Jordan and his wife, Uniel, and then my other best friend, Enoch, and his wife, Melissa, over for brunch. So they came over, and I was excited to show off this new song that I had written, and it was, early Sunday morning, and the smell of coffee and flowers in the air, and birds are chirping, and this song is very, very kind of aggressive and dramatic and not very happy. Yeah. So I play it for them.
It totally was though. He set the stage right though. It's Sunday morning. Brunch
it didn't
is
match.
It smells well. Like eggs in the air. Exactly. You got it.
So I played the song and everybody was just dead quiet. And Enoch's wife Melissa, she said, "I don't like it."
Yeah,
and that became the name of the song.
Yeah.
And she said it just like that.
Just like that. Like horrified. Like
she was, didn't want to. She didn't want to insult a song that I had just written, but she still wanted to be honest, so she kind of crunched up and said, "I don't like it." Although she likes it now.
It's been really funny though, because
it's a great song.
We actually played like a show, and we were outside. Actually, I was going to say this earlier. It's funny we're saying it now. And one of our friends came in, and we just finished the song, and it's dead quiet. There's probably like 100 people in this outside yard. It's really cool.
Oh,
production.
This was Brian Horton's Acoustic Evening, which you should all look up if you like acoustic
guitar. Dude,
it's
awesome. It's really awesome. He walks up and he yells out, "I don't like it." And like everyone was like offended. They're like, "Oh my God." We're all laughing on stage. Like, it's funny.
Yeah,
we're
not in the right tuning to play that one.
See, but you know what?
It was really funny.
It is.
Right. Yeah. And I like when you first said like, "Hey, this is gonna be like the name of the song," I totally was like, "That's the dumbest name ever that I've ever heard of on the song." And I'm so wrong eating my words to this day. Everybody loves that song, and B, they just love the fact that it's something that is like negative, but yet now you can say something negative that's in a positive form.
And it's a great song. Yeah. Yeah. So it is a great name for it. All right, so I can't resist a song title. Red Queen. Yeah.
It's your theme song. It's your theme song.
I know. So,
it's not written about you.
Wait a minute.
She's like, yes, it is.
Yes, it is. What are you talking about?
Well, we hadn't met at the time, though. Unfortunately.
Steal the thunder.
But you know what? I don't care. In my head,
it's about you.
Yeah.
Well, you could apply the principles of the theory to your life if you wanted to, because it's based on the Red Queen from Alice in Wonderland series.
And, I didn't even know that.
She makes a statement, "It takes all the running you can muster just to stay in place." And that phrase is applied to the theory that when you have two competing species in an environment, so for example, you have rabbits and foxes who both live in the Alaskan tundra, okay? And the rabbits who have better camouflage are going to outlive the foxes and avoid being eaten, and they're going to have more offspring, which will most likely have better camouflage. But the foxes that have better eyes are going to catch more rabbits and eat them, and have better foxes with better eyes. So every time one gets an advantage on the other, then one immediately comes in and fills up that niche, and then they're never really gaining an ultimate advantage, they're just keeping in step with each other. So it's how there takes all the evolution that you can muster, but you're never really getting away from where you were at the beginning. You're just sort of avoiding going extinct.
And what's that called? That's called the Red...
It's called the Red Queen Theory because the Red Queen said it takes all the running you can muster just to stay in place.
Now, does everyone see the big bubble above my head going, "What did he say?"
It's probably something you could Google, I would think.
So Red Queen, I doubt the Red Queen thing, and now it talks about, wow.
Yes.
It's a really cool concept, and it makes a lot of sense, actually, but it's just interesting to think about. I'm not even really sure how I feel about it yet.
But it was interesting enough to, actually that's one of the songs that my wife thinks is like the coolest, newest song that we have. She's like, "By hands down, that's the coolest song on the album for her."
You know what? Cheers to
her. I'll
cheers
to
her.
All right, so this Saturday,
Yes.
Yes. You are officially releasing your CD.
I can't wait, yeah.
Oh my God. Yeah, me too.
Yeah, no, I'm like really excited.
You're gonna do it at the studio.
Yes.
At Billings Forge here in Hartford. Mm-hmm. It's at 6 p.m.
Right.
Doors open at 6 p.m.
Doors open at 6, and then you've got a whole, you've got Glenn Roth, which we'll talk about in a second, opening up, right?
Yeah.
And then from there, you move on to an after party at Firebox. You've got Mob Jack and Little Ugly playing at that.
Yeah.
Wow, this is an event.
Yeah.
It's so amazing. Yeah. So tell me about Glenn Roth. Let's talk about him, because I know you guys were psyched about it, because isn't he like some virtuoso?
He's ridiculous.
Yeah, he's insanely talented. He holds true to fingerstyle technique while also incorporating on some songs some interesting pedal and looping work, which I like because he does a little bit of both. He doesn't do just one thing.
I know, right? Totally.
And I've gotten to see Glenn play for years at again Brian Horton's Acoustic Evening.
Yeah.
And we played with him this most recent show, and we asked him if he would be interested in opening for a CD release, and he said he would. And we're so excited because it's the perfect fit for what we're going for.
And what's so cool about him that I really like is that he has like beautiful stuff that like kind of like you can play anywhere, but then you got some like ripping, awesome groove bass funk that just really gets, it's like dance music, you know what I mean? So it's tough to get that combination in one. You know, sometimes it's very classical, it's very ethereal, and other times it's like, happy music, but he does everything. And that's what I really liked about him, because that's kind of what I always strive to play like. Like, I always want to play like really intense and thought-provoking, but at the same time, you can immediately turn right out of it and just play something fun that everyone just has a nice Saturday night, you know, keep listening to it. Yeah. So I'm really excited that we got
him. So you've got Mob Jack and Little Ugly playing too.
Yes. They're the after party, and we wanted to kind of have sort of like a miniature festival. You know what I mean? Like a miniature festival where you could have a performance, and then for those when it's time to go, they can leave. Or for those who want to stick around, because we're only going to finish around 9:15.
Yeah.
So the rest of the night is wide open, and we want to really like encourage like other bands in Hartford that are actually like really, really good.
Oh, yeah.
And if we can encourage that and piggyback back off that to help them, dude, that's awesome.
And
that's what we want to do.
And you know what? And that's why I like you guys, and that's why I like so many of the bands that are involved in this. It's all about, you guys are very supportive of one another.
Yeah,
I mean, you're out for your, you know, you're doing your own thing, and you're doing your best at it. But then at the same time, you're supporting other bands like Little Ugly and Mob Jack, who are amazing too. I've seen Little Ugly multiple times. Mob Jack, I got to check out a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, Little Ugly is what, best rock band in Hartford from Hartford Advocate. So,
yeah.
And Mob Jack is awesome. They have stuff that no one else can do in Connecticut.
Yep.
Now you know I haven't really because I haven't. I we
steel slide
them,
guitar.
Oh, we saw them do like a little acoustic set.
Oh,
and,
really? Yeah, they have a big
seen
schedule.
Their strip down set.
Oh, their strip down
their,
set is very cool.
Person.
I've seen the big. Yeah.
Oh, see, I see that.
Yeah, it's
nice.
It's impressive.
Very nice. All right, so I like to close with an interesting question. Today it's I don't know that it's controversial, but I'm gonna ask you, Carl, because you've been the quiet, reserved one here tonight, and you guys can all pipe in, but when you make your first million, if you haven't already, what are you going to do with it?
I don't think anybody's going to...
Stop it! Dream big! Dream big!
Give it to Lise.
You made your first million.
It's hard for me to do being a music business professor. Because I don't think anybody's going to make $1 million in music anymore, except for a select few. So, if I make $1 million, it's probably going to be through investment banking or some other thing I haven't gotten into yet.
That you don't know about yet?
So, yeah, I mean, that's a discussion I could lecture on for a while. But, yeah, theoretically, if I had $1 million, and if I won the lottery,
$1 million.
I would probably do something really boring with it.
Yes.
I would not.
It would be practical.
Example.
I wouldn't do anything exciting.
Yeah, see, I know you're going to do something good.
Huh? What would you, if you had it, it was just somehow in your account, like, what's that movie where they can't just come talk about it?
Well, I put the maximum in my IRA first.
IRA.
Tax deferment first.
Tax deferment. Listen, kids.
And then.
HSA, anything
to help HSA, absolutely, okay. Because I don't have insurance because I'm a musician. I would probably put some of it into a house, obviously.
My word house, bubble. Why the fuck did I ask him first?
Because I'm the business.
Because you're the practical one.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
Okay. You're not. What are you buying? Leg it out, baby! You know
I'm sorry, but I'm gonna have to tell you that I would probably put the very first million that I had into investment real estate. I'm serious!
We don't spend our money on cocaine. The era is just over. It's over.
We're not playing coke, so, you know.
Yeah, and off of that million, I'd probably make another $6 million within the first 5 years. Because it all goes to investment, sorry. I know it's not what you want to have for a show. I do apologize. You asked a question though, so I gotta answer.
I know. Oh honey, save us.
Save it's us. Not quite as boring. I would want to
boring.
Yeah, I would build a really nice recording studio and outfit it with really, really nice peculiar instruments. The idea being that people who wanted to come and rent the instrument to record on an album, they have a place to get it, like the hang drum, you name it. And also if people just needed a track that had a little bit of hang drum on it, they could call me and say, hey, I know you have one in your studio, so we pay you $700 to record it. So something like that. I'd probably end up going to them for money though.
Joel's the free spirit.
The free spirit.
I guess so.
Nice. Okay, so we are very lucky here at Sea Queen LSG because you guys are going to play, which is awesome. Wait.
Oh, yeah. String theory part is Carl's handwriting.
You guys still want to write across
and
my book.
The rest of it is Rachel's drawing.
Yeah. There. Uh-huh. So I want to thank String Theory.
Thank you.
For doing this tonight. It's so great. It was kind of impromptu with you guys. I'm so excited about Saturday night for you. I can't even and you're gonna tell me.
Yeah, we almost had to do this outside, right?
Yes, we almost had to do this outside. We were almost vagrants out in the streets of Hartford doing this.
Looking for an outlet that would
give us a nice warm alleyway.
We could have put a tin can out.
Oh, we could have made some
cash.
Why not?
Why did you think of that, Mr. Money Man?
I found out about this later.
So, I want to thank you again. We're going to end with you guys playing a song. I'm going to play Little Elephant off in the new album. And I feel so fortunate that you guys did this tonight. I really do, because you know that I'm a huge fan. So
thank
this
God.
Is really, this awesome. Is big for me. So thanks a lot. I appreciate it.
Well, thanks for coming out.
Ready?
Yes.
Let's do it.
Okay, I think we're back now. Sorry about the tremendous delay. I think we got to change that program we're using for that. Lisa, you back?
I am. Am I back?
Yeah, I think so. Hold on a second. Say hi. Test 1, 2, 3.
Hello.
Okay. Yeah, there's a tremendous delay, and I think that program is meant for short clips, not 16-minute long ones.
So,
we'll fix that. Like I said, yeah, this is the first time we did that, so.
So did we, as I left, did we finish the conversation about Swan Day?
Well, pardon me. I'm choking on our wine from all the shots here.
What, pomegranate?
Pomegranate, yeah. Okay, let me see where we are here.
We left off talking about Swan Day, and I just wanted to say a couple of things. First of all, I'm frightened by the fact that it's now a week away, and I'm sort of not ready, but I guess I'll get it together.
You didn't realize it was next week, did you? Because you were talking about the string theory thing being
I was thinking it was more like 2 weeks away, so yeah, that I've lost a little track of time, but it's fine, it'll be fine. So Jen just got some download cards, so they made there are 14 songs that were all donated by past Swan performers. They've donated their songs so that Jen could put this together. They're going to be $8. But if you buy a ticket to Swan online, it's going to be free with your purchase of a ticket. It's a terrific album. The great thing about this download card is that as long as you keep it, you'll be able to, if they decide to add more music from other Swans or things like that, you'll always have that available to you. So anytime they add something to the download card, you'll be able to have it. So I encourage people, I know that as soon as I can get my hands on some, I'm going to carry them around so I can sell a few for Jen. And keep in mind that the proceeds that she receives from these are going to hopefully fund some kind of a grant, which is what she'd like to do ultimately with Swan Day, that will benefit some local female artist or musician. So those are a big deal. Did you talk about the fact that we were on Connecticut Style?
No, that's when you were, I was bringing that up, and then that's when you disappeared off, the internet, so to speak.
Got it. So Jen, asked me a few days ago, if I wanted to appear with her on CT Style, which is a show, on WTNH. And so we did. We went down on Friday and filmed the segment. Jen sang a song, and it was wonderful. We got to meet the lovely and vivacious Teresa LaBarbera. She was the person who actually did the interview. And yes, gentlemen, she did wear a tight shirt. It was a sweater, actually. Pretty pink one.
And
you should actually look for
that.
You
actually were all dressed up, so.
I know. And I felt... while standing next to her was, I'm truly convinced that the camera does not add 10 pounds. It adds 40 pounds. And I had to stand next to that little thing. Oh my God. So yeah, everybody's looking forward to Swan Day. It's going to be great. The performances and all the folks that are involved in it. Jen and her husband, Bob, have worked so hard putting this together. You know, Bob does all the graphics. He put together the beautiful Swan Day posters and the download cards. And he's just, you know, he's really, he's a great man behind the woman in terms of putting Swan together. So, you know, Bob's just great that way.
As another note, the video is actually on our website under Swan Day updates. I moved that date forward. It has your pictures in it from the meet and greet, and now it has the video there too. So,
oh, cool. So the other thing that I wanted to kind of, it segues into this. You know, Sue Menhart, I love you, girl. She's going to be part of Swan. I interviewed her and slacked and didn't do my blog last week, so it's definitely going to be in there this week. Sue, my conversation with her was terrific. She's quite different than what my preconceived notion was about her. She's a hard rockin' chick. I like her a lot, and I think you'll enjoy the interview with her. And I'm excited to see the Sue Menhart band at Swan Day. So just another reason to check out Swan Day on March 31st at the Dirt Salon.
Yep, and it is next weekend.
It is. Oh, you know what? I do want to talk about somebody that I think is just, she's like my superhero over the last 2 weeks. Daphne Lee Martin. Let's just, at first I want to show you this. I don't know if you can see it.
It's a real album. Wow.
It's her. She's got her, Dig and Be Dug is also in vinyl, but the great thing, and I don't know if I'm going to be able to show this appropriately. All this is going to say is that you should really have this album. You should have the vinyl. She's got these amazing liner notes. It's just fantastic. It's really amazing. But the best part was the album. And yeah, I know you're not going to be able to see this, and I hope that you can. It is half blue. It is the prettiest vinyl I think I've ever seen.
You can see it a little bit. You need a better camera.
Can you see the blue?
Yeah. Yeah, we can kind of see it. It looks, yeah, it's bluish on that one half. Yep.
Yeah. Isn't it cool? So anyway, I just wanted to say, I've actually seen her 3 times in the last 2 weeks.
Yeah, I was going to ask, are you guys stalking her?
Like, No. It was really odd the way it happened. She played in one night. What night was that? I don't know. It was the 9th. She played at the Liquid Lounge at the Connecticut Science Center for 4 hours and then ran over to Arch Street to do a set there with Little Ugly. And it was, you know, you would have thought that she would have exhausted herself during those 4 hours, but she didn't. She came and she kicked ass. And then this past weekend, because we really were St. Patrick's Day out, so we really hadn't had any intentions of really going out anywhere. Rob actually saw her post that she had this last-minute gig at Chamard Vineyards in Clinton. So we decided to go out there, and I mean, I guess they do a series. It's every Friday and Saturday night, starting at 5:00. They are doing a singer-songwriter series, so you can go and see local musicians play in this beautiful barn with, you know, you can get a bottle of wine. We had a Merlot that was actually quite good. There was a cart out there with sandwiches, and we sat in these big overstuffed chairs with a coffee table in front of us and just watched Daphne Lee, and Sandy Allen was with her from the Julios and Raise the Rent. And it was magnificent, and we watched the sunset come through these barn doors, and it's really, I've got to tell you, and of course Daphne was great, but if you ever aren't doing something on a Friday or Saturday night and you think, you know, that wine's your thing, go check it out. It was outstanding. It was a really nice night. So
yeah, it sounded like you were having a lot of fun. What do we have left here? Okay, we have the outtakes. Should we do that? That's them having fun with a clicker board. This one shouldn't lose sync. So let's quickly do this. And we'll leave the mics on because it doesn't matter where we talk over this one. So
okay.
Where is it? Go, 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 go.
Okay. 1, 2, 3, now. Louder. 1, 2, 3, now.
Oh, where is that?
Let the clapper go. Real loud.
Or you want to try another?
No.
It's really fine.
Real loud. 1, 2, 3, go.
All right. Excuse me.
Oh, hello.
What?
Oh, sorry. We're filming this.
Yes, dear. I got blueberries, pomegranate.
Pomegranate is what she said. Instead of pomegranate.
Pomegranate.
This is going to make the outtake.
Excuse me, we have pomegranate.
Fabulous. Yes.
I'm going to be editing for a week.
Oh, no.
I'm
going
to be editing for a week.
One, two, three.
Jordan, he was really getting into the clapboard.
Jordan really did think that was a lot of fun. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's actually the first time I've used it out of here. I mean, it's actually pretty. If most people don't know what it's for, it's actually when you do regular video, most people use the camera mics, and we don't. We use a digital recorder, and that's the way you sync things up. You see this giant peak. When you're doing music, you see the drumsticks, so it's the same thing. But with dialogue, you don't have any of that, so it's harder to sync up. So.
Oh,
just a little bit of
I've learned something new today. Thank you very much, Mr. Lawson.
All right, I think that's it. We can do the remember, everybody go see these guys on Saturday. I think it's going to be a good show. I mean, I seriously wasn't going to go, but now I want to go after talking to them. They just had such a good time, so.
Oh yeah. Well, I've got some stuff, just a couple of things that are going on over the next week. On Thursday night, Dave Hogan, you know, I'll say it again 1,000 times, one of the hardest working guys out there in the business in Connecticut. He's going to be at Two Boots in Bridgeport for a happy hour at 5:30. On Thursday as well, Mob Jack, who's going to be doing that CD party for String Theory, are going to be at Outer Space on Thursday night at 8 p.m. Friday night, Manic Productions has got the Slackers at the Space at 7 p.m. Patrick.
We lost her again. Oh, no. All right. Well, I think Lisa needs a new computer. We may have to. Actually, I'm frozen, too. Must be Google Hangout. We couldn't get in today. We had a little bit of an issue. So with that, I think I'm going to end us on the final video that we did. Oh. Yeah, we lost that too. All right. So you have lost my picture. And so I am just going to quickly go to play the video here from that we recorded last night. Okay, we're back. Lisa's back.
Did you lose me?
I think I lost me. So that's what's funny. I think I'm the one who disappeared here. Well, let me get the screen capture back. Come on. Okay, there we are. I actually got booted out this time, which is funny. We've had a bunch of technical issues tonight, but that's par when we do. We're always trying things new, and this was our first time we went out and actually taped something. So we just have to get a better piece of software that plays it in a little better sync. So I'm sure it's something wrong with the way it was formatted. But what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the outtakes, put them on YouTube for the two interviews. So if you want to watch it a little better quality with not going crazy with the doing the Chinese movie Kung Fu thing going, we will put them up there. So you were saying, where else are you going? Or where else did you want to go see?
Where did we start? Where did we end up at Stark Raving Lulu on Friday night?
I think we missed that one.
Because that's definitely where I'm going to be on Friday night, checking them out at Elm Bar at 9 p.m. on Friday. And then on Saturday, of course, you know, the String Theory gig, I think, is the big money maker. But if you can't make it to that show, 1974, which is, you know, a new love of mine, will be at the Space at 6 p.m. And then Grey Light Campfire, again, Dave Hogan, the hardest working man.
And I think Cross-Eyed Cats is also a Groggy Frog, so I might shoot over there on Saturday. So we do want to mention we are planning our benefit again, our American Diabetes Benefit for May 6th. We're waiting on a little bit back from some of the bands we want. It's going to be the same as last year, which is alternate between cover and originals and some people that are mixed. We were trying for 6 bands and cut it down a bit, but it looks like we're creeping back up to 8. We are going to start it later. Down Monday is going to be playing Cross-Eyed Cats so far, Almost Ancient, and Fret Knots, and Lisa's got a couple on. It's building up to be a pretty good venue, or pretty good lineup. So
yeah, I think it's going to be great. I am working on a couple of folks, so stay tuned. We'll have a nice lineup for you. I think it'll be a good mix. It'll be something for everyone.
Well, the biggest thing people took away from last year's, from what I saw, was like, you know, there's this whole thing between cover and originals, which is a false war, because a lot of cover, obviously, I just had John Ryan on, who's probably the biggest cover band explicit there is, and he just formed Down Monday. So that whole thing is just ridiculous. And they tend not to intersect if you're just doing cover music. So when they went to this, even Mike, our sound guy, was just so happy to see original music and to mix it up with a cover scene. So it is two different scenes, I will admit that, but it's they're not a war.
But that the great thing about this show is it brings together that cross section of you know, those who are involved in the original scene and those in the cover scene, and everybody comes together to show love for Mike and all the wonderful things that he does for the local music scene here. And you know, we raise some money for something that's near and dear to his heart, the American Diabetes Foundation. So
yeah, and I mean, we've had a couple of people that can't make it, and they're so guilty. It's like, oh, I'm so bad. I mean, it's like, yeah, we know. But that's why we're trying to make it a different set group every year. Not, I'm going to do DeRosa's thing where he doesn't bring back the same people over and over again. So I think it's fair because they get asked for benefits all the time. So
yeah, spread the love.
Yeah, spread the love. Okay, I think it's a wrap. We're actually pretty good on time. We're 1 hour and 6 minutes, so just over a little bit. And that's including technical issues, so. But
all right, Mike.
All right, we'll see you later. And that's it for Scene Queen LSG number 9 and this week's
number
guest.
Nine.
Although, yeah, I mean, actually, number 10 is going to be, that's it. And you're professional. You're supposed to throw the first 10 away, so, or 9
away.
Oh,
really? Oh, man. Well, no, because we've had some fun.
I know, but I'm just saying, well, yeah, well, I've kind of done these before, but I mean, usually they usually are pretty horrible. And I think the first two were a little bit over technically glitchy, but after that we did okay, I think. So
yeah.
All right, Connecticut, that's it. this is a wrap, and we thank String Theory for coming on last night. They did a bang-up job, and the Red Rock Tavern for just basically saying, yeah, come on, play, whatever. We don't care.
Yeah, that was good.
That was good. Okay, everybody, we'll see you in next week, a couple weeks. I don't know when our next show is.
Yeah, we'll sort it out.
But we try and do this at least twice a month, so. Okay, good night.
Good night.